in the evening. So thanks again for being here. Just in case you haven't seen it, there are other presentations in the other rooms. These are parallel sessions, which take place next door. So if you are here right now, it's because you chose it, because if we analyze in statistics what people would rather be doing right now, these are the top 10. Continue sleeping, a long breakfast, go to other Netflix speeches, play tennis or Tetris. Play or Tetris, depending on the age. The average is kind of low, or watch Netflix. And in the 119th place is the video of what happened on Sunday. Did you watch this video, Lovito? Did you watch the video? There was a spectacular moon eclipse. I'm not referring to what happened with in football with Peñarol. So on the 120th place, that's me, and then 121, the bad things that happen in the world. So sorry for these jokes, but I'm happy that you're here, and I hope that you're all here on your own free will. And I hope that no one forced you, but I have a couple of cousins who are cheering for me. So what's the topic for this presentation? With Gaston, we decided that my presentation will come first. And we decided to discuss what's now and then what's next. For us, it's difficult to organize these presentations because it's not a now and a next. It's an evolution in time. Now is an instant in this world of technology. It's something that happens when you cut time at a certain point. And what's important, it's not what's now, but what's next, what's coming. Because what's now, it's something that will go very fast. And that's what I'm going to discuss with you today. I'd like to tell you how I see the world around us. It's something that we try to model in GeneXus. Firstly, we have the IT industry, where we have the big players, IBM, Oracle, Google, Twitter, Facebook. The big players that are constantly changing the rules of the game, releasing new products, new versions, and making new value proposals. In this same world, we have software engineering. This is another discipline that changes constantly and that extends constantly, like security or testing, softwares, etc. We also have new frameworks or new standards that we have to follow. So it's a dynamic world. The second world that we see is the world of business solutions, which is your world in most of the cases. Most of you develop solutions with GeneXus. This is a world that has to take advantage of technological challenges and opportunities. It's the orange world that you see on the right. It offers a lot of opportunities that have to be taken advantage of by the world you see in green. And then there are business challenges and opportunities. Not only the IT orange world is dynamic, but the business world is dynamic too. New distribution channels, bring your own device, a lot of things that happen in the world of business. And those of us who develop systems have to take advantage of these opportunities. We have then the IT world and the business world, and this would be the bimodal IT. To a certain extent, we people who work in IT have to take into account what happens outside and not only what happens in our businesses. And this is what we have done in GeneXus all our life. Right now, this is the line that we are promoting, but we have been doing it for more than 25 years. So in blue, we have the world of GeneXus. where we have some big promises. Firstly, we are trying to help people create better applications, the easiest possible way. And then, in the middle, we have to automate everything that can be automated. So, from the beginning with GeneXus, that's what we have been striving for, that this orange world of opportunities and challenges can benefit this green world, which is the world of our clients which use our technology. This is the general framework, but being more specific, in order to explain the now or the today, I went backwards. I didn't want to go to Pascal or DB3+. I went to 2008 because I have only half an hour for this presentation. In 2008, there was a change that started in 2007. A decision we made was to implement re-engineering, that is to say, leave the technology that we were using, 3.3, etc., to .NET and others to manage our database of knowledge. This re-engineering made many things possible. Who knows what is what 32.767 is, Enrique? I'm sure you know. No one knows? 32.767. Is the amount of numbers that can be represented in 16 bits, which is what IDE has until the 90. And this coincides with the maximum number of attributes that a database can have until the 90. Now, they are in millions. It's crazy. But those of us that went through the stage of 32.767 value much more the re-engineering of everything you can do with GeneXus. So the EV evolved. We have here the first, the second, the third version, and now that's where we are. EV4. This is a graph that shows the adoption of the evolution. The figures are from August 2015. We see that 49.5 are using Evolution 3, and if those were the percentages in August, I believe that after this event we are going to reach at least 50%. And Salto is in green. It has just started appearing in our figures. Besides the editors and the limit that I mentioned as an anecdote, another thing that is very important is that we adopted extensibility. The previous IDE was monolithic, and after the EX, it became extensible. It could be extended through partners, extensions, user controls, and many flexibility mechanisms. And this made it possible to build a platform. We became a much larger development platform in which we integrated the BPM solution. Then we developed new products like GX Server. So if I go back to the image, to the previous image, we tried to cover things of development that are not specifically development and application. It's working with a team and implement business solutions. And then we had some module for horizontal functions, for example, the GeneXus Access Manager, or GAM, which allows us to manage the user's base. Besides that, the community grew. Up to 120,000 users throughout the world. We always look at this figure, which is very significant for us. But at least for me, something that is very important is the growth of the GeneXus Alliance. We are many software companies that are partners. Some of them develop solutions with GeneXus, others do training for GeneXus or other businesses around GeneXus. And there are some of them that extend GeneXus by developing new partnerships or user controls or extensions. That is to say, extending the platform, extending GeneXus. In the world of technology, all our manufacturers, all those with which we have agreements, many of which are now presenting their vision in this 25th event, complete this three-legged table in the world of applications, the world of IT, and the world of GeneXus. That is to say, for us, it's very good that you are close to these big manufacturers, listening firsthand to what they propose. And among all of us, we can add value for the customer. But a time came where we needed to evolve further. Evolution was a decision in 2008 which brought us here, but this year we decided to make a change in the development process of GeneXus. This change may seem internal, a change in processes, but still I wanted to tell you about it because without any doubt it will affect the delivery of the versions that we are making. So I think that it's good that you are aware of this change. What we did was separate development in two lines that are completely independent. On the one hand, the Salto, and then the Evolution 3 on the other hand. We have the beta channel, which is the one that makes available the Salto version, and then the release channel, which makes available Evolution 3 and the upgrades. In the beta channel, we constantly release night builds until we get to beta. It gives priority to innovation, and then the next beta is released here. The release channel gives priority to stability, and what we have here are previews, which are always stable. We give priority to stability, as I said, until we get to upgrade. To an upgrade. Right now we have upgrade 4, and upgrade X is the upgrade for the future. So this is where we are right now. The Salto line is releasing beta 1, and we have a night build. And here in the release channel, the last release was upgrade 4, and we have a preview of upgrade 5. What is important here? As I said, in the upper line, we give priority to innovation, and in the lower line, we give priority to stability and quality. In this changing world, we want to supply both things. Innovation, on the one hand, for the projects that require that type of innovation, and stability for those projects that want to finish testing or that are in the air and need some kind of change, something new but still keeping stability. Some important consequences of all this. Firstly, you can be in upgrade 4, let's say if you need a stable version, or you could be in a preview. I think that an important difference is that between these two versions, there are very few changes. There are slight improvements. When we say that we release an upgrade, in fact, what we are doing is finish the testing and close all the documentation. But it's not a process in which we start testing the previews. So they are both quite reliable, both the upgrade and the following preview. Another important aspect is the previsibility of the upgrades. It was not very clear for us in the past when to release the upgrades, but since we started with upgrade 4, upgrades are going to be released every 2 months. So I can tell you that on November 9th at 4 p.m., because my colleague lives at 5, you don't have a birthday or anything like that? Okay. So, on November 9, at 4 p.m. we are going to release upgrade 5. I think that this is important because of these three worlds that turn. We are aware that we have a responsibility vis-a-vis the clients that trust GeneXus. So what we try to do is to keep these two development lines separate. Without getting too much in depth, I need to tell you about our third line. What happens with innovation in this table line? I said we have the Salto, which is innovative, the other line, which is stable. And what happens with innovation? So we have an internal version that corresponds to Evolution 3. It's called Trunk. And all new things are always implemented in the Salto version. But some of them, after being tested in Salto, are going to be taken to the internal version where they are tested again. And if they work well, then and only then. Well, I had a late night yesterday. So, as I was saying, after they are tested in internal version, they are released in a preview. Therefore, the implementation is born in the upper line, tested in the middle line, and released in the lower line. For example, to give you a concrete case, Apple has just released the iOS 9. I'm killing the interpreters, he says. So Apple has just released the iOS 9 and the Xcode 7. We need the support of Xcode 7. It would be good to have it at least, because the old one is still functioning and you can upload applications that execute the iOS 9. So what we are doing is implement here the support of the Xcode 9, then we're going to move it here and release it here. Do you understand more or less what I'm trying to show you? So, at the end of the day, we have two channels and you choose the one you want to follow. Well, I see that I don't have much time left. Nicolas said that a modern application needs these three components: the web, the clouds, and the apps, which are native applications. Web development, what we've done these last times was to reach maturity for the smooth applications and the responsive world design. We have improved the responsive editor. Also, these are the editor, and as Nicolas said, we have improved the applications that we create, which is a kind of a library. We have extended all these applications. These are examples of what we supply. Here we have the applications for this event, and in the left, another responsive application that you can use. And what we have done is what our partners have done, the partners that belong to the green world and develop systems with GeneXus. One of them developed an application for Old Mutual, which is an important insurance company in Mexico. The salespeople use this application in order to give quotes for their products. Another application is the one that was developed for Rico. It's a very well-known brand that supplies office equipment. This is the portal so that the distributors of Rico interact with their customers. And again, it's an application that is seen one way in the mobile phone, and according to the device, the information is organized in a different way. So this is a responsive application. Another one that I think is important to share with you is the CyberLink application. They are here today. It's a software house that developed a solution for retail. So it's a retail management system and they have several thousand supermarkets in Japan, and now they are using a GeneXus solution. It's not easy to see it on the screen, but this is a master retail. You have a list of products, a detail of the products, and this is a screen where they can control the stocks of the various articles. And who can guess what this is? Well, this is actually a supermarket layout which shows what should be in each shelf in the supermarket at a certain point in time. It was difficult to do the rollout in 1,500 supermarkets, but now they have done it, and it's critical for the business. The people from Simplifica also made an application for red tickets. You can get a code with this application and buy the tickets, and the occasional client can buy a ticket with the web application. Ignacio Roqueta yesterday was talking about web-friendly versus native applications, and people will rarely download an application in order to buy a theater ticket. That is why they made it web-responsive. This is the same application, and I can choose my seat and buy it online if I want to attend a theater function. Simplifica also developed an application for French farmers that own more, or that get, that gathers more than 40 groups, and they do their tax returns with this application, and they can also trace seeds. This is another application that can be used in the desktop, in the mobile phone, etc. SunGiant is a Chinese software house that developed an application for SMEs. I was thinking of you, Mario, when I was thinking of this application that helps SMEs to do their financial statements. And they expect to have 1 million customers using these applications. And for those who subscribe to the service, they can provide a native application in the mobile phone, and they also have a web application. And since this is the world of the apps, lately we have achieved a very high level of interface and device integration. We can now use the maps and some native applications of the mobile devices, like location, etc. Then the maturity of offline applications. This is another scheme that we have been developing, and we are also focusing on corporate applications. The Mexican League application you've seen several times already, and this is the application of the event. It has an interesting look and feel. It's not very obvious for some of you, but here there is a whole question of design based on the latest concept of user experience by Android. This is Univali Notes, which is used by 25,000 students of Univali University, and students can compare their grades with those of other students. That's very interesting, and it has a lot of positive reviews in the stores, which is interesting. This is an application of GX Consultants of Chile. Colum is a dairy industry in Chile, one of the main dairy companies that distributes dairy products throughout Chile. And for me, what's interesting is that it's an application that works online and offline, because those who take orders for dairy products have to travel throughout Chile, and they can synchronize the orders when they are able to go online, and then the products have to be delivered the next day. What is important is that the information is recorded and sent very quickly. And the application is so good that they managed to establish new business models. Those who take the orders now can make new customers because they visit supermarkets, for example, and sometimes they get new clients and they have about 50,000 lines of products and handle about 5,000 orders per day. Zoom is a software house that has a transportation solution. The drivers of the trucks can download this application, and the business scheme is interesting. The drivers download the applications, register their vehicles, and according to the geographic area in which they are and the characteristics of the vehicle, they receive notifications about the kind of trip they can follow or the route. I don't know whether you've seen this in movies. Someone wants to carry something from one place to the next, and according to the kind of truck they are driving, the authorization is given or not, and the truck driver decides whether to transport that those goods in particular or not. Then Codelco is a mining company in Chile, and they use this application in order to control the trucks in the tolls or the entries of the mining sites. It can also work online and offline. And the three leg of this table is the cloud. And here I wrote new platform. Jose yesterday said the cloud is like the new standard. In the past, you would think a Tomcat or a .NET, but today, naturally, we think of the cloud. We've been there for several years, and with Mario the other day, we were discussing how long had been in the cloud. He said since the 18, but now you are 25, so you've been in the cloud for 7 years. It's the new platform. We are offering the possibility of making prototypes in the cloud. We've been doing that for 4 years, and we've had prototypes for at least 65,000 applications. Now we are launching in this event, GeneXus Cloud, which is basically something that has three parts. It's developed with GeneXus, then the deployment of the application is made through the Cloud Manager, and then the hosting of the application is done with various hosting providers. If you want to see it in GeneXus, instead of having of doing F5 or X6, we are asked for information, my credentials, so the deployment is made. This is the deployment in the cloud, and here I can enter the cloud manager and back up or look at the information I have, the versions of the application that I have deployed. All the management can be done here. With GeneXus applications, anyone can do a deployment in any of the clouds. With the F6, what we are doing today is this. This is what we are deploying automatically. We are very close to having a version for Bluemix, and we are working on the deployment on these other cloud providers. I could end here, but I have one more thing to say. I have to talk about integration in order to complete the three-legged table, because they are less stable than a four-leg table. And the four-leg would be integration. We have been working on the ERP connector for SAP. I'm not going to get into details because Luis is going to make a presentation this afternoon with Eugenio. They are going to explain what all this is about, but it's about integrating GeneXus applications with SAP. And K2B has also developed a connector. Van Total is working with it. And following the concept of extensibility, anyone can develop connectors for different platforms. Besides the connector for SAP, we developed the GeneXus Meli SDK for Mercado Libre. Mercado Libre has a database, they have an API, and their own application is based on all this. I don't know whether you heard Karen's conference about the opportunities that this application offers. What we did was to include in GeneXus this API from Mercado Libre, consolidating it in the database, and then we produce an application that consumes this API in a much more natural way. These are REST services, and there's no complexity here. We just did it and distributed it, and anyone could have done it. So what we are trying to do is to simplify the way to integration. And to sum up, these three worlds should increase customer value. Nicolas yesterday said nothing more eloquent, nothing is more eloquent than action. He heard this sentence from Mariano, but actually it was Shakespeare who said action is eloquent. For me, what's next? It's up to you. Thank you very much.